most of you, I think, know me, but if not, I will introduce myself. My name is Elizabeth Reed, and I teach in the fashion merchandising sequence. So Dr. Gum invited me to come here to talk about sort of a path or a journey that I took a couple years ago with experimenting and how to be sustainable within my own wardrobe. So I want to ask you first, though, before I start anything, why you chose fashion? Why did you, just anybody can shout out why you chose fashion. And it could be the shallowest and silliest reason, it's okay. Why are you here? Like, why did you choose fashion merchandising or fashion design if that's what your major is? You don't know? Anybody? Yeah, Sarah.
When I was little, I tried to sketch my own designs all the time, but so I wanted to do that since I was little, but when I grew up, I didn't want to sketch itself, so I decided to do merchandising.
But so why? Because you still loved clothing or what? Okay. What else?
I was like two different majors before this, and this was the only thing that really cut my interest.
Okay. What else? Any other reasons? I mean, Megan.
I've loved sewing like ever since I was little. Okay. My mom taught me how to do it. So.
Okay. With design, that part of it too, and creating something.
And drawing and everything.
Okay, great.
Okay, I guess fashion is never ending. It's, you know, evolving every time. So it's like, I think it's
always
like,
something new.
Yeah,
it's exciting like that. Okay. Yeah. Well, I would say that that's probably, you know, one of the reasons why I got into fashion as well is that it is exciting and fun. But also, I love clothes. I've always loved clothes. I have loved clothes for my whole life. You know, it's like this love affair that probably we all can relate to, right? And shopping and all of that, right? I was the girl in junior high and high school that I had half my wardrobe lent out to all my friends because I had so much clothes that they, you know, would come and get my clothes. And drove my mom crazy about shopping all the time and never having enough, to the point where I ended up having a clothing allowance. So it wasn't just my regular allowance that I earned the chore. You know, I had chores that I had to do. I also had a clothing allowance that I had to do things for in order to get, I think it was like $50 or $60 a month at the time. That was a big deal for me to be able to have that much money to go shopping when I was 15 at the mall. And the mall was the place to be for sure at that time as well. So shopping has always just been something that I love to do, and I love clothing. So even though I actually went to school for architecture, I love design as well. So I realized that architecture wasn't what I wanted to do, and being within a design program, I would see the fashion students there too, and I thought, well, why didn't I choose that? I should have done that. You know, I love design, I love clothing, all of that, and it's so much more instantaneous. Like, you know, when you're designing for architecture, the buildings could take years until you see anything. But I could design something that day and make it that night, and I'd be able to wear it, you know? So it was so much more instant gratification, you know, than rather than with architecture. So that's what I ended up going back for my master's degree for that, and continued just to, you know, love clothing and be inspired by different designers and all of that. And then I started teaching, and some things changed a little bit, because I started researching a lot more about what I wanted to tell everybody in my classes. So beyond just, you know, most of you have had me for textiles, so beyond just learning about the fiber's characteristics, then I started learning about the processes that are behind those fibers and the factories and the people that are making the clothing and the, you know, all of the extra stuff that wasn't so much fun to learn about, really, on many levels, right? So then, as I started digging deeper and deeper into that, it was really heartbreaking. It's like a bad breakup with somebody that you've loved for a really long time, because I love clothing and I love to shop, and I'm realizing I really shouldn't love this anymore because of the way it's done and the way the processes and the people that are behind it. And so then I started to think, okay, I really should walk the talk a little bit. If I am telling my students all of this information and giving them all the facts of things that are happening behind, you know, the growth of cotton and all the pesticides and things that are used on that, or learning about the people at these factories that are making our clothing and, you know, what's the truth behind all of that. So I shouldn't be going on these, you know, shopping sprees and not worrying about that either. Then, if I'm telling my students that, then I should be walking the talk, right? So I decided also at the time, it was 2011, so I had just had my second child and had about 7 different sizes in my closet because of having a baby. Some people are a little luckier than others and don't have that issue, but so, you know, I had my pre-pregnancy size that I got back into after having my first child, and then I got pregnant, and within like the second that I got pregnant, I think I was in a bigger size, because the second baby, your body knows this is what we're doing, you know. And so then I had that size, you know, and then maternity clothing, and then gigantic clothing near the end, and then back into some, you know, some pretty big clothing still after having the baby, and then, you know, finally back to sort of pre-pregnancy size, but not quite. And things are different too, is the way they fit. So I had all these clothes in my closet, some that I could wear, some that I'm hoping to wear, some that, you know, are maybe too big at that point. So it was so overwhelming at that time too, that it was just like, oh, I am telling my students all this stuff. I want to like just get rid of everything and start again because of all these different sizes in my closet. So that's what I decided to do, is I said, I'm going to create a blog and I'm going to make some rules for myself that I have to follow. And I'm going to do it for as long as I kind of can, you know, maybe this year, for 1 year, you know, 9 months, something like that, and see how well I do. So I created the list, and those are the rules that you guys have there. So we can kind of go through those, and I posted them on this blog that I started, okay? And so I tried to make it my sustainable wardrobe. So I was kind of starting fresh in many ways because of, you know, several months after having a baby and trying to, like, you know, fit into something again. So here, these are the beginning of the rules. So any new items, if I were to purchase any new items, they have to be of these fibers. So this is the list that I created: organic cotton, flax or linen, piece silk, organic wool, alpaca, any kind of recycled fibers, lyocell or hemp, and then small amounts of spandex could be within there, but only if absolutely necessary, because of you know, required stretch or something like that I really wanted. So then the second one was my overall wardrobe should have a consistent color palette. So this is something that's really difficult to think about within the fashion world, and how everything changes so quickly, right? And new colors are happening all the time, and what's the hot color for this year, the Pantone color of the year, whatever it might be. That is really difficult to, you know, you go into a store and that the color can sometimes be what brings you in, right? Like, oh my gosh, look at this great, you know, purple color or orange or whatever is really popular that season. So that's part of one of the problems, though, is we get sucked into those trends and those colorways, and it might not really work with, first of all, our skin color, second of all, everything else we have in our wardrobe, our clothing, but also shoes, things like that. I have a pair of, like, now these were given to me by a friend, so it's okay, that are like a coral sort of color, a coral suede, okay? So they're coral and they're suede. So I can't wear them right now because of the weather. I mean, I could wear boots here and then put them on, but I still feel weird about, because they're suede, I feel like I should wear them in the wintertime, in the fall, you know, I can't, and then they're coral, so I can't really wear them in the spring because of their suede. So it's like, it doesn't really, so in any case, they're coral, so they don't match with many things, right? They're definitely like a statement sort of pair of shoes. So they are not easily, you know, can be paired with lots of different things. So I should purchase things that are a colorway that works with my skin tone and my colors that I, you know, personally enjoy, and then the things that work with my other things in my closet. So what inspired me about all this too is that while my wardrobe was like going back and forth all the time, and I'm constantly going through all this different stuff and taking things to Goodwill, whatever, my husband's wardrobe always stays very much the same, very easy, very simple, and that's because men shop in a very narrow color palette, right? They don't have all these vibrant colors for the most part that they're wearing all the time. They're not inspired by different trends. They're not. So I was trying to kind of use his wardrobe as a guide, in that he chooses very particular colors, and so I should probably choose very particular colors as well. Number 3 was, when purchasing a new item, this item should coordinate with multiple or at least 3 other items within my wardrobe. So this one you know, goes along with that color palette as well. So not just the color though, but the style of it, what can I pair it with? If I get a jacket, if I get like a really dark, you know, blue jacket, do I have enough pieces in my closet that it's going to work with that? Or is it something that's just a statement piece that's only going to be worn like those coral shoes once in a great while, right? So that's another important part of it. And then I added this too because of, you know, being comfortable. That was when I was going through all this stuff with all these different sizes in my closet that I have to be, you know, happy with the size. I'm not going to buy transitional clothing. I had bought so much transitional clothing from having a baby that I was over it. So I wanted to be, you know, happy with that size and stay at that size. So it's not like you're always going back and forth between different things that fit. I will purchase only easy care products, no dry cleaning allowed. That's, you know, all the chemicals that are used in dry cleaning are really detrimental to the environment. And most of the time, even though it says dry clean only, you probably can do some things to it, hand wash, things like that, that you, or, you know, do your own sort of dry clean, which is picking something off, you know, if it spills. But you can do some other more natural alternatives to that. I will only purchase items that I envision myself wearing for at least the next 5 or more years. That one was really difficult too, right? To say that you're gonna have something that you're gonna be able to wear for a long time. So this is something too, I think with age, you know, it helps because, you know, when you're younger, you are into more trends, but it can also be something that you think about just making it work in multiple different ways, you know? So if it works in be more casual, and then also you can dress it up or whatever, then you might be able to have it for a little bit longer time. Let's see, number 7, I will only purchase products from manufacturers with a transparent supply chain and that work towards promoting sustainable practices within their production. So this one would require some research. So I'm not going to be at the store and just be able to be like, oh, that's cute, and this fits some of the rules, so I'm going to take that, right? It has to be brands that I'm familiar with or that I do some research on before I buy them and investigate them a little bit. And I've said this in some of my, if you've taken 329 before, but that, you know, the website is really the voice of the company. And so if I can't find this information readily available on their website or in hang tags or labels or something, then they obviously do not have a transparent supply chain. They're not being open with what they're doing, okay? Number 8 is I will only purchase products from manufacturers who enforce socially responsible practices. That goes along with the same thing. This should be very available and easy to see on their website as well. Number 9, really tough. I will not consume more clothing than one person requires for his or her lifestyle, right? So that's really difficult, right? Because we probably could live on a very little amount of clothing. But when we really want to consider our lifestyle, then we can probably add a few more pieces to that. Have you guys done the, have they done the wardrobe diet yet? Okay, do they know about it? Can I tell them or no?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, yeah, Dr. Gahn will challenge you to do something similar to this about wearing only so many pieces for a certain amount of time. And it's really interesting because I think you'll really get a lot out of that by seeing what are your favorite pieces, you know, what are your go-tos, what really works the best in your closet. We all have those, you know, like if we could duplicate so many of our pieces that we really love and be able to wear those all the time, that'd be great, right? So I kind of had some categories of things that I feel like these are the categories of clothing that I need, you know, and I don't need to go above and beyond in those categories more than is necessary. Luckily, I also live in an old house. It was built in the 1920s, so that means I have a really small closet. So it was also part of it, too, that, you know, I only have so much room in this closet. I will constantly evaluate my wardrobe. When I see a void or feel the need for an item in particular, I will create a shopping list. So this is just like any other items in your life, like your groceries or something. You know, we do so much just like on impulse or just because I love it. You know, you're at the mall, you're at a store, you fall in love with something, that's what it is. So instead, I'm really making this conscious effort to evaluate, like know what I have in my closet and know, like, you know, I never wear that particular top because it doesn't have the right pair of pants to go with it or something. You know, then I'm going to be on the search for that pair of pants versus just like being at TJ Maxx and finding something that I don't necessarily need, but it's a great deal and, you know, it fits, and so there you go. When purchasing a new item, I will evaluate my wardrobe for any item that I may no longer use to make room for more useful items. So things that I did get on sale on a whim that I only wear once or twice, is it really something that I'm going to wear frequently? Then let's, you know, pass that on and move in this piece that's going to be more useful to me. I tried several different apps for number 12 and never found one that I liked, but that was a part of this mission that I would have liked to have done. But by minimizing my wardrobe, I wanted to catalog everything. So that way when you're at the store, you'd be able to say, oh, this would really work well with this piece. Or, you know, there's pieces that you forget, you know, when you have so many clothing items, there's things that are behind hangers and stuff like, oh yeah, I forgot about that. You know, this would work well with it. Or when you transition from fall to, you know, summer and things like that, you forget about things that from the other season. So I thought if I could catalog everything and have that with me at all times, that when I'm at the store and, you know, want to remember, I could have that shopping list on it, I could have those things, then I'd be able to do that. But photographing everything in your closet takes a really long time, and I don't have the time for that. First of all, I started it, and then the pictures weren't that great of quality either because of the lighting in my bedroom and, you know, like how, so I wanted all that to come through really well, so it was, that was difficult. And I never really found something that was exactly what I wanted. They had like, it was more like shopping apps, things like that, versus maybe there's something now, but in 2011, 2012 when I did this, there wasn't anything that I really liked. But by minimizing my wardrobe, though, I think I have a good catalog in my head now, because I don't have such a big wardrobe anymore that I can remember what I have a lot more. So we also just renovated our closet too, so that really helped. Did a whole built-in thing, so that helped to organize it all. I will choose to purchase items from local or individually owned retailers and boutiques over purchasing the same product at a larger chain or big box type store, even though the cost may be higher. So this is something, thinking about, you know, shopping local and putting that money towards all the taxes that when you shop local and then are gonna go towards the things that you use, you know, so thinking about, and the local business owners, that kind of thing. I will only purchase items online that promise to be shipped to me using a minimal amount of packaging and little to no printed advertising within the box or envelope. You guys know this, when you've ordered things online, it all comes to you with all this other stuff that you don't need, and they're trying to get you to buy more. You know, so I would really like to be able to purchase items that are not, that don't have all this stuff with it, right? I will bring my own bag. So I already do that when I go grocery shopping, and it's like, well, why aren't I doing that when I go to the mall? You know, when I was like in junior high, I wanted to be like Pretty Woman and have, you know, like 75 bags on each arm walking through the mall like that. So this is like a 180 from who I used to be. So I want to have no names on them. I just want to have my own bag, put those items in there, and they don't need to wrap it up in tissue and do a whole presentation for me, right? That's just all extra. This is so, you know, maybe unnecessary. This is also completely the opposite of what I talk about in fashion promotion as well. Because packaging and all of that stuff is part of promotion, but at the same time, it's kind of hurting so much. And then number 16, I will record everything that I purchase on this blog. Okay, so those were the rules that I really wanted to stick by. I had some, you know, if possible sort of rules if I could do it. I will purchase pieces that are multi-seasonal and that can be layered throughout the year. If you guys haven't heard about the Zero Waste lady, have you talked about her, the Zero Waste
they
family?
They just watched the video.
Johnson, mm-hmm. Yeah, so she hasn't had any trash in like a year and all that stuff. I'm very inspired by her as well, but she has some really great things going for her. One, she lives in California, in San Francisco, outside San Francisco. And so the weather is not what we have here, right? So she can wear things throughout the year. She's not transitioning her closet like we are. She doesn't, you know, so they have seasonless sort of wardrobes, which is really nice. And she's going to have layering pieces and things like that for colder San Francisco days, but she doesn't have to have, like, you know, snow pants and, you know, all the extra stuff that we have to have, that winter gear sort of stuff, and then, you know, hot, warm weather clothing as well. So trying to, as best you can, though, to try to find pieces that will be more seasonless. Like, you know, if I find a sleeveless top, is it something that I could put under a sweater or a jacket or something for the wintertime, too? Is it the appropriate color and style that could be used throughout all the season? All seasons. I will purchase items that have been dyed using natural dye stuff or printed with non-toxic earth-based inks. the if possible part, of, I put that under here. Of course, I would love to make that one of my actual rules, but then I would probably buy no clothing because hardly anything is done in that way. It's very difficult to find natural dye stuff products. And when looking for a particular item, I will first research to see if it is available secondhand. So this is like if I needed a black skirt, let's just say, like a, you know, a basic black pencil skirt, all right? So instead of going to the mall to find that, you know, I could probably find that at Goodwill or the Mission or some other secondhand store. So start there first before going somewhere else. If the product does not follow all the wardrobe rules but gives back to an appropriate cause or utilizes fair trade practices that serve deserving people of a developing nation, whatever it might be, right, I will weigh various rationale and consider purchasing the item. So examples like Tom's Shoes, places like that that are doing really good things and moving in such a positive direction, but maybe not all of their products follow the rules, then maybe I can make some exceptions in that way as well. And the same thing, just shopping local, you know, it doesn't follow the rules, but it's made local. Like I go to a arts fair and there's a really neat, you know, scarf that's made by a local artist and it's done in this whatever way, then maybe I can, you know, I would want to purchase some. And it works with, you know, lots of things in my closet. Like I have all of that rationale behind it too, but maybe it's made of something else. Then I have some items that I'll show you that I purchased like that. And then end up thinking about the items that I am transitioning out of my wardrobe. I'll try to repair as much as you can. That's what I'm going to do, and replace zippers, other things. Even if it's more expensive to do that, to get a new zipper put in something, I'll take it and get it fixed. Because I know I probably could find that, you know, somewhere else with a new zipper. But what's going to happen to that piece? If I give it to Goodwill with a broken zipper, who's going to wear that? They're going to throw it away, right? So I should fix that first and then, you know, continue to wear it, even if it's more expensive than doing that, than buying a new one. Tears, rips, or stains that are beyond mended, some things that, you know, maybe you spilled something on, there's just no way it's going to come out, you know, oil stains, things like that, that are just not going to come out of there, so I can maybe make it into rags for my home, or then it also ends up in these bins over here that might need that. And then I will seek manufacturers who accept donations to recycle their clothing. So like Patagonia has the program to recycle their clothing, so that way instead of maybe doing this, or otherwise if it's the right type of fiber that they want, then I could give it that way and then they can recycle it in the ways that they want, okay? So those were the initial rules. Obviously these are really strict, idealistic, utopia type of rules, right? It's very, very difficult to follow all of them. So let me see what I did first. Oh, then this is a real problem, is that about a week and a half after I made these rules, I have this annual girls trip with all my friends from high school that we go shopping for the weekend. Yeah. That was not good. They were really mad at me for doing this because I was the one that brought it all on. I was the big time shopper. They were like, oh, what's she gonna buy this year? You know, how much she's gonna buy? And all I bought was a hat, one hat. And they were like, oh, you're no fun anymore. So we went shopping at Oak Brook and did all that stuff. And I ended up buying a hat. So this was something I did. You know, I could feel that void within my closet of needing maybe another hat for, this is several years old now, and I'll talk about that. So this was really unique because have you guys heard of Crochet Kids? Some of you have, some of you haven't. It's These were the labels that were on the hat, buy a hat, change a life, and so you have this image on there. And then really cool that it says this tag on it too, look inside your hat and see who made it. So this was like, oh, I can buy this. This looks like it follows my rules, right? And really inside, there it is, that there's the person's name, she actually signed it. And then you can even scan that or just log on there and go on to their website, and then you can actually put the person's name in and find who made it. Really cool. There's her picture. There she is. Really transparent, right? So following a lot of the rules that I've said. And then you can write her a letter, a note to tell her thank you for making it for you. So I just fell in love with that whole concept. I thought that was really good. So I purchased that. I talk about it. Did I follow the rules? Yes and no. Do I really need another hat? Yes. I mean, you know, living in Illinois, you could definitely use another hat. But the thing that broke the rules about this is the fiber content. Because it's made of 90% acrylic and 10% nylon. Really bad fibers, right? Not good choices for this. Now, the reasons why it was acrylic and nylon is because it was, I don't know how much it was. I think it was only $26. So if it was wool, organic wool or something, you know, it would be 48 or something more, right? It would be a lot more. It was in the Nordstrom, like, juniors sort of area, something like contemporary section, something like that. So the price point is lower there. So it's going to be, you know, in that junior section there, by the VP stuff, all that, is going to be a lower price point. So that's why they wanted it to sell in that particular area. So that's why it was $26 and made of acrylic and nylon. If they would have been a nicer organic fiber, then it would have been a higher price. But the problem with this is, look at it now, right? It's made of acrylic, so it's all fuzzy and pilly. And, you know, I've worn it a lot, definitely worn it a lot, but I would like to wear it for even more longer than that, right? So, unfortunately, because it's made of nylon, nylon and acrylic, it's going to pill really bad. Think I can do anything to it? Like, use the razor or something on it, maybe? I don't know, to try to fix it a little bit. But I wish that it would have been made out of something else, and I would have probably paid the $48 for a nice hat that's going to last me for... The color is great. It's going to match with any jacket that I ever wear for the most part. You know, it's a neutral color in that way. So it fit a lot of the rules, but unfortunately, because of time with the fiber, it hasn't held up very well. But that was a fun purchase, and I really, that company is a really great one to choose from. There's me in the hat. Okay. So walking the talk again, I got rid of a lot of my Uggs. My little boy's Uggs, and I was trying to look for some boots that were more appropriate for the weather that we have, more functional for, you know, that are going to get trashed for the most part with walking through all this muck that we have, you know. I researched all different companies, these smart wool boots. I like them, but obviously not practical for lots of different outfits with that design on them. So these were the boots I ended up getting, these Patagonia boots. It was actually before Christmas, and he did bring me those, so that was good. I used some Christmas money to purchase them. And then also purchased these gloves, which I did bring of different colorways. These were made from old sweaters that they felted or just cut up and then made into gloves, and they have hats and scarves and that kind of thing. It's Baba Zuzu. Sounds like a little kid's first word, but so these gloves, I like them. I think they're funky and fun, and they do match with different things, but because they don't have the fingers at all, like, then they're not something I can wear, obviously, to drive in or anything, but then even, like, walking my kid up to school, like, oh, these fingers just, like, freeze. I always am like, no, I just wish they had the extra little mitten part, you know what I mean, to go on top of them. So as far as functionality, you know, but and they've held up really well. They're wool, so they're going to hold up a lot better. Let me see. Next one. I think I have how the everything arrived. Okay. Oh, wait. Let me do the... Okay, so I did spend some Christmas money on some things that I researched. I went to the Threads for Thought website. It's another company that I had, you know, done a lot of research on. And I just needed some basic items that I wanted to purchase. And then also, these were the pants that I had, these Nike, like, workout yoga sort of pants. And they're made from 100% recycled, or really used, so it's hard to see. The legendary pants. It's 10 less plastic bottles, you know, one legendary pant, and it's all made from recycled polyester. I loved the fit of these pants. They are still in, you know, good shape, except for some cat hair, dog hair on them right now, but still in really great shape, feel really great still, just really nice quality item. They were $98 when I purchased these. This was before the blog and everything. So, but I liked that they were made out of this, I brought them in, it had to have been 2010 or something, and they still are in great shape. But so those were $98. I wanted to get another pair of pants like that, but I didn't have $98 to spend on them. So I was trying to look for something else that would still be, you know, reasonable, and I just wanted a pair of pants. Like, I had that pair of pants, and I had some other ones that I would never, like, be seen outside my house in, because they had, like, stains and things like that. But I just need some, like, lounge stuff around my house with my kids to play with them, or, you know, go up to the park, things like that. And I didn't want to, you know, buy 70 plus whatever pair of pants. So I found these on Hanes. They are EcoSmart Cotton Rich Women's Drawstring Sweatpants. So I'm like, those are just perfect for whatever, lounging around, not a big deal. And they were $12. I'm like, they're $12? That's crazy. So I'm gonna like, and they're EcoSmart. What's the deal? So I look on it and I research it a little bit more, and it says that they are only, what is it? 80% cotton, it doesn't say organic cotton, 15% polyester, and then only 5% recycled polyester. And they're still advertising that as the number one thing is that they're EcoSmart. But it's only 5% recycled polyester. Like, they couldn't have upped that a little bit more. But the price point, and that's probably why too, it was $12, so that's why they only put that 5% in there. However, I made some choices here to just, because these companies are trying to put this in a little bit, they're trying to communicate to the customer a little bit about these other fibers. I thought, I want to put that money, even though it's not 100%, I want to put it towards that, because they're moving in the right direction. So I hope that they will, continue to do that, add more, to know that there are customers buying this and wanting this, then maybe they'll add more to it. So I got that, and then I just got this really basic sweatshirt as well. And then the threads for thought was like a crazy deal. It was the $12 a piece. They were 60% organic cotton and 40% recycled polyester. I thought, man, that's an ideal fabric combination. This is gonna be fantastic. And they were like buy three, with free shipping, it's a grand total of $30 for four shirts. It was crazy. And I got all these, I just wanted like basic type t-shirts, sort of long sleeve t-shirts to go under sweaters or whatever. And I talk a little bit about recycled polyester there. So that was really great. Unfortunately, the way it arrived to me though, was like that. Those were all the ones from Threads for Thought. So they were all, each individually wrapped in plastic. So who works retail? How does everything comes wrapped in plastic, right? Every single, think about all that plastic. Every single item has to be wrapped in plastic. Really, it has to be wrapped in plastic, and so that's how they arrived. I was really furious about that. And even when I sent the order, how they have a notes or comment section, I wrote that in there. Please, no packaging. They didn't listen to me. So I emailed them and told them I was very discouraged about this because it was, it's Threads for Thought. It's supposed to be that this is who they are, and they should, same thing, walk the talk like I'm trying to do. So, and then they wrote back and said, it took several days for them to come back, and they said, we appreciate your concern. We make every effort to try to be, sustainable, blah, blah, blah. This time, this is how things are packaged and all that kind of thing. So they didn't even give me a coupon or anything. But and then Hanes, this is how the Hanes one arrived. Now, they'll get a little bit better grade. Even though they wrapped it in plastic, it was the, biodegradable plastic, which is, who knows if it really is or not, but at least it's trying to be. And it was also in a cardboard, like paper one, a packaging versus where this was in that plastic, bag packaging too. I just can't believe that their packaging isn't, And then, of course, Patagonia, packaging wins because they have all cardboard, all paper, everything. I try to tell my kids that very easy way for them to know what's recyclable or not. It's like what's going to go back into the earth and what's not, right? So paper, plastic, paper, cardboard, all those things we could bury in our backyard, and eventually it would just like decompose, like it would look gross for a while and get all limpy and everything. We did that to a plastic bag, it would just never do that. So, I just can't believe Threads for Thought doesn't have packaging like this. They should be consistent with all of their material. Okay, so my boots I did not bring because they are really trash right now from yesterday, my Patagonia boots. I love them. They are really great for the ones that arrived in this box and those black ones. They're definitely not like if I lived in Alaska, I don't think they'd be warm enough, but they're fine if I have like the right socks. They're not like super, super warm like a pair of Uggs when you put those on. But they are... they still look brand new when I clean them. I just get the salt stuff off of them. I could just wipe them with a paper towel or something, and they look fine. And then, they held up. They've held up really, really well.
And will you tell us about why you selected that boots?
Because the Patagonia ones. Right. Oh, yeah. Well, they were all made from Patagonia is, you know, amazing. Or did I find it? Or maybe that was in.
Mm-hmm.
When I got rid of that, so. These are all, this is the everything, you know, what it's made from. 20% recycled EVA footbed, 20% recycled EVA insole, recycled Patagonia air cushion plus. Everything's made of recycled material. It's still not, you know, it's, it warms off 100% recycled polyester lining, all of that. And then you can see also their transparency as far as everything that they do. You can go on and see where the factories that they make everything. I mean, their website is incredible. So you can find all the information that you would possibly want right there about the people that are making them, the fiber content that it, you know, is made out of, all of that. Okay. I do want to show you, though, really quick, my Threads for Thought shirts several years later now. They are really, you know, thin, so it's not something, I definitely have to wear it underneath something. I ended up kind of wearing them to bed because they're just so, like, flimsy almost. They're very soft and everything, but they're very pilly, so I'll pass it around too. So because they're polyester, and even though it's recycled polyester and organic cotton, they have pilled something terrible. So they're knock around, like, I'm not going to be seen, you know, outside my home kind of shirts like that, which is really... You know, even though they were inexpensive, I was hoping by the fiber content that they would be a little bit more, I don't know, last a little bit longer for me, but they didn't. Okay, what else did I do here? Let's see, March. Oh, I went on the radio to talk about it. Fit equals, that's what I added, that rule about fit equals function. So fit, you know, is so important. Then I went to New York City with some students for a study tour that year in 2012, and so I knew I was going to be in New York City. So, like, okay, I'm going to be on a mission to look for certain things. We're definitely busy. So I had a shopping list, just like with anything else. I had a shopping list, like I said, I was going to set out to do, and so these are the places that I wanted to find. At the time, I wanted to go to the actual Patagonia store because I had, you know, done a lot online. I've been to Patagonia stores before, but not the one in New York City, so I wanted to check that one out just for fun anyways. And then Levi's and H&M, because they had that, at that time it was new for them to have that conscious collection. And then with Levi's, they had this waterless denim that they were advertising at the time, that instead of dyeing it with all, or treating it with all of the water and chemicals, they were taking the water out of it to try to make it less, just, you know, less waste of water. And then any kind of vintage store, secondhand stores, I mean, my gosh, in New York City, what could I find, right, in all those places? So that was kind of the mission and the list, but, you know, of course, our study tours are very busy and we're doing lots of different things, so I didn't have the vintage stores, we actually didn't have time to go do, but I did, you know, I went to, Levi, and they had this marine layer brand there, which I've since learned a lot about, but I thought that was interesting. The labels on the sustainably made in USA by adults, fabric custom milled by marine layer. You know, whenever brands are being transparent like that with their labels, that tells you something. That's an open invitation for us to go explore more. So if they're doing that, then they must be doing pretty well behind closed doors as well. Because otherwise they're just going to get more people asking questions. So then I tried to look on their websites and stuff before. So I bought a T-shirt from that, a pair of hemp linen pants from Patagonia. It was like the summertime, so they were like, you know, casual sort of pants to wear with sandals. I thought about, they had like a capri length too, and I thought about that, but I thought this would work better for leading into the fall, even though they were that linen sort of, and the black too, trying to go back to all of those. I did really like this scarf, and that was, you know, it wasn't quite much the breaking the rules. It was New York City. It was really hard. I did my best. This is from Century 21, which is like a TJ Maxx sort of, you know, and Sarah Jessica Parker always went in there and in Sex and the City. So it's like a hyped up TJ Maxx. And so I only came out with one scarf, which was incredible. Unlike my former self, to go to a place like that. And then it was a silk wool blend, so that was good. Natural fibers, goes with a lot of pieces. And then I did get sucked into this just because I love pattern design. And this is this, I love this textile designer, Orla Kiley, and she had just made this whole relationship with Uniqlo, and they did. They had so much, so I got this top, and this one does go. I could put this under a sweater and wear in the fall and everything too. So it does, you know, more than anything, I think I've learned from a lot of these pieces that they're not going to follow my rules for the most part completely, but I have this catalog in my head of what I have in my closet, and I know if it's going to work and how it's going to work with other pieces, and that has really changed the way that I've shopped too. We visited this company called Anvil that you probably recognize if you look at any of your, like, just basic t-shirts, anything like that you've gotten, like Redbird t-shirts or sorority shirts, things like that. It's that kind of brand, and you can get, you know, different things screen printed on them. And they are an amazing company, very similar to Patagonia with everything that they're doing. And it was a really fun visit. They fed us Chipotle and gave us all these shirts and stuff. It was really great. And toured us around their office, and they gave us these two shirts. This was, I brought this one in. Used to be a plastic water bottle, so it's more like a marketing sort of shirt for recycled polyester. This one's held up pretty well. Obviously, I haven't worn it as much because it's just like that kind of t-shirt, you know. I'll wear it to textiles on the day that we're doing, if we're talking about recycled polyester, or I'll wear it like to work out or something, but it's not anything like, but it's made from recycled polyester, and they have their label on there of, actually it's organic ring spun cotton and then recycled polyester. They've got their label like that on there. And they really work to make things like this, but inexpensive. So it's only a couple dollars more to, like, if you're going to do a shirt for your sorority or something like that, use Anvil and their collection like this. It's only like $2 more per shirt versus the, you know, conventional cotton. So they really work to make things really inexpensive. It was this one. This was Vivian Westwood, is another designer that really works to make things sustainable, and she had this whole Green Up initiative that she worked with Anvil and made this design. I was really disappointed that I wasn't able to find the waterless denim like I wanted to. There was one style hidden. It wasn't advertised anywhere. It was just this little handprint, like, is the logo for the waterless, and it wasn't on any, like, there wasn't a display for it or a table or anything like that. I had to search for it, and then I had somebody help me, and they were like, I think so-and-so knows about that. Hold on a second, you know, and then they had to get that person, and it wasn't. So it just was like, oh, darn, you know, this was a huge store in Manhattan. You'd think that, like, they would have advertised that a little bit better, but. And then the same thing for the Conscious Collection. I think I mentioned that somewhere. Same thing, like, no table, no nothing, like, as far as a special display or anything like that within H&M. You know, and I went to, I think, two or three different H&Ms to try to discover this a little bit more, and it was, like, in the back, over to the right, like, it, you know, and also things were mixed in with other things. It wasn't part of, like, one collection. It was, like, you're flipping through things, oh, I like this shirt, oh, by chance, it just has to be part of the, you know, it happens to be part of the Conscious Collection when others weren't, and so it, you have to kind of go through everything to be able to find those pieces, where I thought, you know, if you really advertise it effectively and promote it that way, people like me will buy that because of the label that's on it, not, you know, necessarily because I got sucked into the style of it. I'm going to see the label and the information behind it and know that it was made in a responsible way, and then I'll start looking at the style of it. So that was that. And then I spent the summertime and I cheated because I, like, oh, it was like withdrawal, you know? I had to get things. So I bought some stuff that do not really follow the rules, and I laid it all out here, what I purchased. Well, I don't make any excuses, you know, it was really difficult to do this for that long, you know, so it was like quitting anything, like smoking or something. It was just like, I had to do it one time, you know, and all those pieces are still in my closet. Let me look back, except for the jeans maybe, and this top is still there, but it's really pilly, but everything else is still there, going strong, yeah. And then, but my other part of it that I have discovered to fill that void is to go to shop secondhand. You can find so much, and it's amazing. I mean, you can find so many things, and you don't have to, like, look at the tags, you know? It's like, oh, I can go, this is like my dream come true. I can shop and never look at a price tag. I can buy anything and everything. And so it is, it's just like, to me, it's like a lot like going to TJ Maxx and, you know, trying to find pieces that are, you know, going to work with many things, but going through all the stuff and everything that's there is really tough. And then this is the last part of it, was just this bag that I purchased, and it's been a really Another thing that I just researched a lot and really found different things. I was really struggling with all the stuff I had to carry around for my kids. I didn't want a diaper bag anymore, but I still have to carry around their Hot Wheel cars and crayons and all this other stuff. So when we're out to dinner, they're not going crazy and, you know, all that. But then I have my own things for work and makeup or whatever else I have. So this bag was great because it fit all the rules of being made out of all recycled content, made in a responsible way, and it had like two parts. So I could put all my stuff over here, their stuff over here. My son was still in diapers at that time. Oh. And then it has a cooling sort of part in the middle, so I could put like sippy cups or things like that, or even like, you know, a snack for me or whatever for work, I could put that in there. So it was a really smart bag. It's actually called the Working Girl Bag. And I have purchased a couple other purses since then, and this is like still, I go back to this every time. It's getting a little beat up, but it still is like, whole, you know, it's still going pretty strong. And I just changed back into it a couple weeks ago because it was like, it's so nice because it's organized and you know where to find things and I've got the separate compartments and it still is held up really well. So that was my whole journey. I think from doing all of those, I really learned a lot. And like I said, the things that I really, my takeaways from it are definitely that I do a lot more research when I buy something. I hardly ever have any impulse buys, once in a great, great while. Nothing like what I would have had before. I went to TJ Maxx recently to buy, I know I wanted a pair of jeans, and I was gonna start there. I'm just like, I'm gonna start there and see. I wanted to get a pair of like darker jeans. And I found them, and I researched now you know you can research the company online and different things, find a little bit of information. They fit really well, so that always, for me, trumps so much because something fits really well. And I know I knew what I wanted because of that void in my closet. The other ones that I had were a little too short or a little too long. I need the right length. I'm 5'4", so I'm always like in the middle of that. And so that void that was in my closet, I was going out to shop specifically for that. I didn't buy anything else. I didn't, you know, get sucked into any of the other things. There were lots of other things I would have loved to have bought, and my former self would have loved to have purchased, but I was going there for that, and that is what I ended up getting. You know, if I did find something that I really liked, I might take a picture of it, think about it a little bit more, and come back for it, and if it's not there, then it's just, you know, not meant to be. But, you know, to think about it a little bit more, to just rest easy on it for a while, and then go back. So that was a big, you know, thing that I've really taken away from that. And to simplify my closet so much that there is this very specific color palette that I choose from, so that makes it so much easier for me to purchase items that, like, ooh, I like that, but it's not going to work with this and this and this. It's going to be very something that I just wear on a very small time, and what's the point of that, you know? Luckily, I do have, you know, at this point of my life, I don't go out that much, so I don't have, like, you know, those choices in that way. And, you know, I have to, my money also is used for so much of the stuff with my kids, too. So I'd rather buy them cute things anymore than for me oftentimes, too. But, so, there, you know, this stage of my life is a good time to make those choices and do it in that way. So, but, you know, by walking the talk, it helps me in my teaching, too, to make sure that I'm, you know, I'm really doing what I say in the classroom and try to be, you know, the person that I'm communicating to, for all of you to be leaders in the industry in that way and be responsible and ask those questions about where something comes from and where, who's making it and that kind of thing. Know that I am doing that too, so, yeah. So that's where I am. What questions do you guys have for me? Anything? Yeah?
Do you do this for your kids too?
Next to impossible to
that's
do it for
what
them. Yeah. But I do buy a lot of secondhand for them because I'm so glad I do because they are so picky. I can't even, actually, I just went to Goodwill the other day because I was on a mission for my son has like 5 pair of pants that are good, like go-to pants. And I'm like, you know, he just needs like one more because I don't like to do laundry during the week. So if he could just make it, and sometimes he has 2 pairs of pants in one day, you know. So if he just had like 1 or 2 pair of pants, he'd be good for the whole week. And I had looked at a couple of places, and I'm like, you know, I should just go to Goodwill. I'm going to see what they have. Found 2 pairs of pants for him that was great, or actually maybe 3, and a pair of baseball pants for him because he's going to need that for this summer. There was a little hole in them. I'll get a patch on him. He'll be good to go. Then my other son, he's like a football fanatic right now, but he wants numbers on his shirts, and they have to be double digits. So I found this shirt that has number 92 on it. I was super excited about it. And so I gave it to him, and he's like, oh, yeah, you know, it's 97 cents. He turns around, there's not a number on the back. The players have numbers on their backs, Mommy. You know, that can't, and so we're gonna, he's not going to wear it. He will not probably wear it. So I could bribe him with something, or you know, but he won't. So spending any amount of money on something is really hard for me to do when they're so picky like that. And I have done that for them before, and it's heartbreaking. Like, please just wear this for me. I spent $28 on it, whatever it is, and they won't do it. So I have a lot of fun buying stuff for them there because there's lots of things that hopefully they'll like, and if they don't, then it's, and I'm just going to go back to Goodwill. It's a little contribution to Goodwill, 97 cents for that sweatshirt. So, you know, it's very difficult. Luckily, because I have two boys, like, I will buy nicer quality stuff for my older son, knowing that hopefully the picky one will eventually wear it, but, you know, at least it you know, will go to him at some point. Shoes for them, I always send them to the, Nike has a recycle program, so their shoes is one thing that they can't pass down to the other one because they destroy them so much. So you can box up all of your shoes, and if you give your shoes to Goodwill or the Mission, they're going to throw them out probably because they're, you know, somebody else wore them, unless they're really in good shape. So they will recycle that and use it for all kinds of different surfaces like tennis courts and, you know, like softer basketball courts, things like that. So they'll grind them all up. It's called Nike Grind. And because I have an architecture background, several of my friends, they spec out, like on their drawings, Nike Grind at different athletic centers and stuff. So they attest to the quality of that. So I love that I can contribute to that in some way. So their shoes always, I always save several of them and box them up. And especially now I'm on a mission for another pair of shoes for my son because he cut his shoes. That's another thing too. Scissors are really fun to cut through clothing and see what happens if you cut the clothes. When you're three, that's just exploring what scissors do. So yeah, it's really, I would love to be able to purchase things like that for them, but yeah. But secondhand, I think, is the way to do it. I mean, that to me now, probably the biggest take back of anything is to go shop secondhand. It is a big surprise if you have never done it before. Nothing my former self would never have been caught. And, you know, like I said, I wanted to be a pretty woman holding all those bags and everything. And I never would have thought that I would, and I talked to my mom about this, you know, that I'm going, she's like, who are you? I cannot believe you're going to Goodwill, you know? But I find so many great things there. On the flip side, you can find, it's really sad to go there too because of how all this polyester and the synthetic fibers are not meant to last. And so, you know, there's so much stuff that has pilling or all the knits that have holes in them. And so you see the flip side of all of this fast fashion too, that we have so much of it, but then so that you can buy secondhand things that are, you know, still in style, but then they're pilly and, you know, faded and that kind of thing because of not good quality overall. Anything else? Well, good luck with your wardrobe diet that you'll do here soon. I'll be anxious to hear about how everybody does. And I'm really glad that you're taking this class. It's a really great component of your resume to make sure that you put that on there because sustainability is not just a trend within the industry, it is really a responsibility that we all have now to make sure that, you know, the clothing that we're wearing is not made by people that are losing their life because of it, or the toxic chemicals that are used to create it are not, you know, contaminating waterways, all the things that really truly do happen from our fast fashion. So well, thanks for having me come today.
Thank you.